You only have 10 minutes? How much of this flights and days?
You can travel for the decision.
Okay, thank you very much. Good afternoon, I'm Pablo Rodriguez, I'm the president of the world. I tell you to evaluate the technology capacity for the administration. This work is related to the acquisition of competencies and evaluation of competencies in the national physiotherapy degree. The first question I want to put in context is that in health science learning, there are a high number of students. At the same time, the number of practical lessons is very high, and the equipment and instruments necessary for these practical lessons are very specialized and expensive. So, due to the majority of the places, it's difficult for the student to acquire the proper competencies. So, in order to avoid the barrier for the student to acquire these competencies for the future professional practice, we propose the use of virtual laboratories, virtual laboratories, the generation of virtual material, in order to have the proper acquisition of these practical competencies, but not only that, but also the evaluation of them for the profession. Master degrees, for example, but also a support for the classical face-to-face bachelor program. We have a high wide scope of health learning. We chose the physiology subject in order to propose a didactical packages and methodology to acquire very concrete set of specific competencies. These are related to the blood perfusion and circulatory system. So, it's very important also to point out that these competencies to be acquired by the students are acquired when the students deal with different cases, with different situations. So, it's very important for the students go to the laboratory and practice and take part into the constraints I commented previously. The possibility of to have for the students these materials to practice at home is very important for the students' work and also to acquire the students. As I comment, we propose a didactical activity in the subject of physiology related to the and related also to the identification of Raynaud's syndrome. It is a sentiment that the family is in the process. Now for them, you propose the system. I would like only to comment that the difficulty of this kind of virtual laboratory is that we avoid the degrees of nursery and physiotherapy. And the other question is that this particular material can be used for the professor to be sharp in the subject and to emphasize what are the competencies to be acquired with the same method. So, in order to explain this. Well, very briefly, I comment the case of the identification of an obstacle. Okay, in order to do a proper computation and the student can visualize and interact with them at home. Here there is a sequence of the different images acquired with this protocol, so before the test and after the thermal stress. We only with the protocol palette the variation of the patterns, the thermal and superficial temperature, which is related to the platform. And this is the kind of set that is provided to the student in order to identify, for example, the thermal asymmetry of any kind of pathology or different or discrepancy according to a normal or standard size. So, with the proposed study in region, in different regions of interest, students can, for example, compute this kind of graph. So they can see these key points, how is the thermal recovery, and of course it can be linked to another competencies, for example, when the change is statistically significant in order to evaluate the total recovery of any kind of additional flow. For example, detection of thermal asymmetry, higher thermal change, etc., and as I commented, the identification of this and this operation can be carried out with free and open source software. This is to be applied in two subjects from the nursery of physiotherapy degrees. These are the competencies, which are also in the article that can be evaluated and applied by the student using this approach. And this approach is carried out using these three criteria, which is according to the literature. Especially the economic one, which is the very key cost time for us. In order to be time, I will, in the workflow, is only to comment very briefly that the first question is that these virtual materials can be shared to different subjects, to different professors. So the first question, these virtual materials can be useful to acquire competencies for my subject. In the positive case, it's carried out the acquisition, but there will be subject where these virtual materials are no use or no better than the classical approach. Okay? This is a complementary way, not in order to replace it. So we prepare an individual work package for the students, video lectures, tutorials about the use of the software, etc. And with these thermographs can be proposed the use of a competence evaluation package. So the student can evaluate another set of thermographs and evaluate if the subject has some kind of syndrome, etc. And this can be load in the Moodle, for example, provide to the student a directive feedback. So, in order to finish, this line of work is a continuation of the previous work in the previous Teams conference, which is related to the generation of virtual materials in the cloud-site learning. It's a low-code approach because only specialized hardware is a thermographic camera. And this approach tries to fulfill the three criteria from the literature, the economic, the reality, and the quality one. And the future step, we need to, of course, in this present course, evaluate the improvement of the performance of the student using this method. So, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Paul. To avoid today, just hold on your questions until the end of the presentation. Right? So, the next presentation is entitled Virtual Design Environment for Specificity Improvement of this Improvement. I'm going to deliver by Juan Alberto García Estela.
Is one of the most effective as a set method to training plasticity because of his efficacy and his low probability of complication. And ultrasound is the better reactivity because it's the most recommendable, is safe, effective, and well tolerated. Allows a better time visualization of the filtration area, so it's easy for the professional to guide the needle to the correct position. Make possible the localization of different structures such as veins, bones, nerves. So it's important to avoid to find the cancer. It's the only technique that makes possible to see the amount of brain mutation injectives. It's important because the patient can be harmed. And it's the only technique that allows to isolate the tip of the needle in the part that with the procedimientos in this industry, so it's very important as contrast, is highly dependent on the experience of the operator, has a high learning curve, and the key is out of frame. Because of this, one of the successful helpful tools is the virtual learning environments. The virtual learning environments can access the university education for professionals that have the difficulty to go to presential learning. The possibility of collaborating with different multimedia content, make possible accessibility of the knowledge of experts, very important, and get feedback in general relations, experts to students, students to experts to improve the different pedagogical methods or systems, and the students to another student, because the students can be of different fields, so they can use the same information to learn. And then make possible the accessibility training everywhere and every time, important, and the acquisition of knowledge and skills of expert safety through the simulation, avoiding to practice with their classes. It should limit autonomous lead, fluid pressure without ethical issues, and possibility of learning on infrequent case, so it can be possible to do a specific case from specific activities. So our goal is to train health professionals in the training and spasticity with a virtual learning partner. In the University of Salamanca, we have to offer a master in integral training of spasticity to learn about this. So our virtual learning environment involves evaluation tests to evaluate the for the students, but on the, also the method, the professional, and other and also the things. Of course, we have a master noticial final project, a lot of theoretical content, different discussion forums with the same information to support technical support or different issues. And the most important thing, the multimedia resources. We have content as video, images, and a simulator. The simulator possibilitates to see in real time with some image, training with a virtual probe, and training with a virtual image. So, theoretical content organizes in different modules. Each module has different documents that the student can learn. The multimedia resource can be images of different muscular anatomical muscular ocular parts and different examples of patients and the same with the data. In the simulator, one of the things that the student can do is to practice with a virtual probe. They can use the virtual probe and move with the mouse of his computer, and in real time will be the ultrasound correspondent related with the position in the virtual model. So he can learn where is the different parts of the human body in the ultrasound, and related it with the human body. With the needle, the same, the student can, first of all, variate the angle of the needle. in real time, he can delay the different parts of the construction image and learn where is the correct place to inject the full images. The evaluation tests are multi-choice for the student, are multi-choice with 20 or 30 questions, are in a Q format, and half question and the question and choice, the change randomly to the student or copies. There are limited of attempts and time also to our copies, and the false substrate for part of the global rating. This is an example of the substrate. The master final projects are real case, of application of infrastructure like auto-limit dosing, infiltration treatment. They have to do a description of the clinical case, a diagnostic or test for the patient, and they have to do a diagnostic plan, and to finish they have to describe the infiltration process. The discussion forum, there are different people involved, students of course, and a professional of health that is the professor, and a group of technical support that is the expert in computer science that allows the support the leadership mentor with the leaders and the members of the culture. As conclusion, our aim is to form a virtual environment to train professionals of different health teams, such as primary care, different hospital services, or geriatric residents. Our video is intended to professional with higher education, so or with experience in the education of dermatology. Our video facilitates the creation of self knowledge for the training of the real patient, and of course, it is a substitute in case. Thank you very much for your presentation.
So the next presentation is entitled the effectiveness of infrared thermography monitoring ventilation performance of the pulmonary smash. This is data on training, a professional simulation study in nursing students.
We Additionally, we also registered the CPR performance by people some regulation, some documentation for parameters that are in Spain, volume, weight, and what we see that new ventilation rates were
So the medical evaluation process has different types.
points, starting by a search of information. And we are going to highlight this new machines that can be divided into two groups. And in this case, the oxygen saturation is like a specific indicator of the hypoxia. This information will be evaluated by the doctor, and a treatment will be developed. So our idea basically is to propose a system applied in telemedicine to detect this possible charge of hypoxemia in an early way. So the doctor will tell the patient please to establish this application in a mobile device, and he will have to produce some data regarding his state or her state of health. Then, only we can also ask him about other risk factors, and the daily use is simple. The patient just has to take measures with the sensors of the system, and if they are strange, because the system has regulated the normal values of the patient, an alert can be generated. So in this moment, there is no like technical evaluation of the measurements in the device, and they are also sent to the doctor, who will evaluate them, the history of the patient, and also other risk factors. We are going to obtain so two kinds of evaluation, that are technical and the medical one, that are given to an expert system. It is obtained a global hypoxemia risk that will allow us to establish one of these three states for the state of health of the patient. That can be weight, attention, or emergency. So once you have understood the idea, we can go to the methodology. Basically, we propose a methodology with this chart. It has here the information, the input, that is the information from sensors and also from the expert, because of this evaluation. This information is treated through two different systems, and we obtain as its outputs two kinds of risks, that are the technical risk, obtained of the technical evaluations, and the expert risk, which is obtained from the evaluation of the doctor. Then we have the internal definition of the system that can be seen here, and that relates how we are going to relate the technical and the expert risk in order to get the global risk that I have previously presented. And finally, this risk is evaluated and the state of this, the system is established. So, how do we relate the global risk with the technical and the expert risk through this equation? It's equal to technical risk multiplied by a function which depends on technical and expert risk. Okay. There is a thing in this equation, and it's explained because of the minimum value of the technical risk. In that situation, we obtain that the global risk is equal to the decision factor, this function of the expert risk. This allows us, or makes that in that situation, the doctor is the only one person who can decide whether the patient is bad or good. So, what should be the behavior of the system? Well, it is related to the definition. In the case of technical risk that are smaller, or lower, sorry, than 50%, we are going to use exponential functions. These functions allow us to obtain big values of decision factors with big expert risk, so that big global risk, and in the short to obtain values of global risk that are the lower. In the case of technical risk targeting 50%, we are going to use logarithmic functions. In this case, we are obtaining like an under evaluation of this person, and then the value of the global risk is growing faster. With this definition, we can build up the surface of the decision factor versus both risk estimate and the technical one. So now we have the value of the decision factor, technical risk, and we combine them to obtain the global risk. Okay. So this is the equation, and this is the shape of the surface of the global risk versus the bottom. It's important to highlight the transition zone between the low and high risk that I will take it to the later. Okay. So we can do some improvements in this methodology that are corrections of health level, because maybe the expert doesn't agree with the behavior of the system. And also in the second level, that correction, what is making is to establish like a soft transition between the low and high risk. And they are optional. As I told you, maybe the expert one another kind of slow, and here maybe he doesn't want that under evaluation. And regarding the second level, we establish like a sigmoid transition between the low and high risk. There are several different possibilities, and this is just an anomaly. So for giving you a refresh, we have started with information that comes from two sources, that are the expert and the sensor. This information is treated through two different systems, and then made two risks. From this risk, we obtain a decision pattern and a global risk. The expert want to do any correction of fair level, as I told you before. So we would obtain a new global risk. And also can do a second level correction, a new global risk. This is evaluated and we establish a state for this patient. We have programmed this on the lab, and regarding the Fujifilm different systems, we have used the Fujifilm toolbox. Okay, just for concluding, we have proposed a novel methodology in the field of telemedicine to be applied for detecting and preventing possible charges of hypoxemia. This made possible is like a tool that allows the doctor to help him during his work, to improve the monitoring process and reduce the time to help these people who is under a possible hypoxemia charge. This is important to highlight that this versatility to be applied also in other files, in other sites. So, as we can have the technical and expert risk that we need to combine to just a single file. So, thank you for your attention. Thank you very much. So we are going now to start with this presentation that is the design and prototyping of a new device for supplying oxygen and other pharmaceuticals to newborn babies. Basically, it's the design of a new device to be applied in this field of oxygen therapy to give oxygen to these babies. So we are going to establish like this organization for this presentation, starting with a brief introduction of why this is important. Then we will present the design of the device following a well-known methodology in the file of design. And finally, we will give the conclusions obtained after this work. So nowadays, there are more than 15 million of premature babies each year in the world who needs some kind of oxygen therapy. The thing is that nowadays, the devices that are in the market are not enough adapted to their needs. They are causing ulcers and other kind of problems. So the goal of this is to design an ergonomic device that is adapted to this specific group, that allows to lower the pressure and increase the possible effects in critical areas, and increase the versatility and usability of the current devices that are in the market. So we have done a survey in the hospital of Ourense, who was done by 55 people who are working in this space. The reason that we did this service to these people is because these babies cannot tell us their needs. And the main conclusion we got from them is that this device should not cause skin, irritations over the skin or ulcers. It should be adapted to this group because it can happen that there are not many sizes for these babies in some devices. It should be easy to position and to move the baby, and also that it should be compatible with other treatments like giving a pacifier, feeding the baby, giving oral drugs, nebulizing, etc. So, from these user needs, we have translated them into engineering language that is established the design requirements that are the inputs of the next step of the design process. So, several concepts were developed, and this one is the final one which was developed, and has evolved into the last version. You can see that this formed through different straps that are placed over the head of the baby. Then a tube is guiding the oxygen through the nose of the baby, and then we have a mask. But we have to highlight that this mask is not positioned by pressure. I mean, what we are doing is to use a hydrocolloid and a velcro strip in order to place without causing pressure in the face of the baby, so that we are not causing pulses. Furthermore, this kind of material, the hydrocolloid, is used in some cases to cure that pulses. Okay. So, well, this is the final idea to develop. We have gone through the tele-design step. We have gone through the solid works and we have taken several geometric forms in order to simulate the face. So we have obtained two designs. This one, which is just for delivering oxygen, and the other one, which is a variation. The first one, what we do is just to unplug the plug of this one and look at an evaluation that is complex. Okay, just we are going to highlight two. The green pieces are green and the ruby ones. Are flexible, and regarding this is a commercial piece. We have made a prototype using a total cable 3D printer, it's a cheap 3D printer. We have used mainly two types of material that are Filaflex and PLA, just PLA for rigid pieces, and Violet Filaflex for the flexible. Here we have the photos of the different parts that were manufactured, and we can see here the two prototypes that were made. We have also tested the device. I mean, not tested with this. We have tested with a nebulizer for seeing if it can
work with high functions. And it supports functions from 6 to 10 liters per minute, which is not common. I mean, these functions are not used commonly. For concluding, just saying that the proposed design allows us to give oxygen to babies. It might avoid the formation of ulcers and skin irritation because of what I told you about the hydrocolloid and Belbox. It's possible to use this device for other kind of therapies, oral drugs, nebulizer, giving food to the baby, moving the baby using a pacifier without any kind of problem. So finally, thank you for your attention.
The integration of the model
The modification is due in the including CPG in the portal which will pass the full expression. Now opening the 3D modeling, it's the useful 3D modeling, and then rotating the image, full time and 3D model compiles. When it's okay or it's a good quality, then we can save it in several formats, including a PDF 3D. Results, three-dimensional model are generated by column rendering and shape in portal document format. PDF software has a number of tools to work with the model. We can use a 3D navigator tool with some photo, and we can reduce or enhance the model, showing in an area of interest, pronounce. It's also possible to move it in all directions, rotate it, and then a panoramic view. Let's take easily an agile form with points directly in the model by most point. The three model allows to hide or display moment surfaces some regions of the model. Beside, we can select two sections and we can see the model in various sagittal, axial, frontal, or oblique plane. We can define various parameters, camera angle, focus, alignment, as we can see the model in different visions in the same model. It allows customize the basic function according to the preference of the user. It is possible to hide or incorporate custom views according to the interest of the user. An obvious usefulness of this model is the use in implementing the drawings. For the creation of the plan to match the facial model. This model reflects the true anatomy of vessels. The size currently is frequently used in models, and it is facilitated thanks to the versatility and compatibility with the software with the most different device. Discussion. The acceleration of digital technology has allowed the accuracy, stabilization, and efficiency to generate 3D images. The digitalization of medical needs has allowed the integration of practical radiological image in a managed flow format and allowed to perform measures protected with the security of PDF format for checking this file and preserving digital information is allowed. Now, this technology is widely used in medical sciences, particularly in medicine, is used for anatomical models, usually surgical training, as it is one of surgical guides, instrumentation, new plant, etc. In this model, visualization and manipulation of things generate better interest in the user. A new step forward in technology is a cinematic rendering. This technology produces a photorealistic image made by 3D CT or 3D MRI scan with automatic visualizations. This technology is inspired by the entertainment industry based on the computer animation program used in cinema. To finally, conclusion, 3D image represents better compressibility in a larger time. Computing makes the 3D image more efficient and reduce processing time. These 3D techniques allow you to share and transmit information with model use quickly and quickly. Three-dimensional model in PDF provides the advantage of three-dimensional visualization with PDF document files. The medical image in 3D technology is being taken as a starting point for various future work. The cinematic rendering, three-dimensional, and there are several strategies for the combination of 3D medical image and artificial intelligence. Thank you. last presentation before the coffee break is that the green mention of the legal works for this old pathway and the reports to the same level of interest will be delivered by the Catherine from Jan. Thank you.
In a bank of nerves
currently the fevers are have a distribution where the hospital track, which is the most important track of our study, is located at the posterior link. It's represented here in this picture as blue and orange color. So, however, over the last years, different studies have been carried out on the location of the fever tracks in the internal capsule, and they provide reasons that have controversy regarding the pre-established distribution. These are some examples of the controversy of the distribution in the internal capsule of the fever tracks. So because of that, we wanted to analyze fever tracks distribution, especially the corticospinal tract, because we have been studying this pathway deeply for several years. In order to perform the study, we have included 30 patients with non-posterior strokes or injuries and other events that cause significant morphology, pathological morphology alteration. The radiological study was carried out on a magnetic resonance sequence of General Electric in a 1.5 delta. We only use the ETA, as you can see in here, and the T2 sequence passes in echo, just only to check the anatomy. So the software program that we have used for the post-processing was the AWServer 3.2x2.0 from General Electric. So during the investigation, we have done almost three post-processing steps. Initially, we isolate the whole the internal capsule, as you can see in here with the drawings, where we put the internal capsule. And in the tractographic representation, as you can see in the second and the third picture, the tractographic reveals the symmetry of the direction of the nerve fiber that project the cortex of the frontal to the frontal, parietal and posterior occipital cortex. The second step, in the second post-processing step, we isolate the anterior limb, represented in red here, and the posterior limb represented in blue, and by several people. As you can see in the cartographic representation, most of the blue fibers from the posterior limb are projected through the cortex, but from the frontal and the parietal lobes. As you can see in here, just frontal and parietal lobes. Then, in order to separate accurately the fever tracks, we select some different areas from with the drawing. We in both limbs. In the posterior limb, where we draw in blue and orange color, most of the blue and orange color have, as you can see, it have vertical direction through the frontal and parietal lobes. With this step, we can say that at least the corticospinal tract is located in the posterior limb. However, if you pay attention in this image, you can see that there are some fevers, blue and orange fever, located in different situations than the parietal or frontal lobes, as you can see in here, that goes through the occipital lobes for the cortex. So there's some difference. So considering the literature, we can say that there are similarities regarding the location of the fever tracts that cross the internal capsule, specifically the corticospinal tract, where we demonstrate that most of the fevers is located in the posterior limb. And in conclusion, so as you can see here, that we have already. So in conclusion, despite the existing controversy, there is no significant difference regarding the location material transmitted into the visual system so based on the visual installation are performed by presentation of the blue wiring crystal using the computer mount. This is a description of advancing computer technologies and the latest communication techniques have been incorporated
different.